Hey, everybody. Thanks for joining us. My name is Jason Topsy. I'm the communications director for AARP Indiana, and we are joined today by Adam Wren, who is the contributing editor for Politico and Indianapolis Monthly and the publisher of the newsletter website and newsletter Importantville for all you Indiana Hoosiers out there that are looking for their political fix. That is a good place to go. It's up on the screen. Encourage you guys to go check that out and subscribe and all that fun stuff. But first, before we get in, hear from Adam and talk a little bit about the Indiana's 5th Congressional District race, as well as the governor's race here in our state, just want to touch base a little bit about what AARP Indiana has been doing around our voter engagement. AARP for over 30 years now has been doing nonpartisan voter engagement, where we are informing voters about not only the power of the 50 plus voter, but also the issues that matter to the 50 plus voter and their families. Obviously, this year is different than most in the fact that there is a global pandemic happening and we are having an election during it. So therefore, we are having to adapt. And what we just keep on saying and encouraging everybody out there, because election is rapidly approaching. We're starting to get, I think we're close to single digits, if not single digits, by the time you see this, of when election day is going to be happening. To make sure that if you haven't voted already, that you make your plan to do so. If you have received an absentee ballot and you have not sent it in, you need to do that as soon as possible to make sure that it gets there on time. And so we just want to make sure that however you're going to vote, whichever you're going to vote, make sure that you do it safe. And so with that, I am going to let Adam introduce himself a little bit. Adam, tell us a little bit about yourself and just what's it been like out just overall this election season for you?
Sure. Well, I'm a Buckeye born Hoosier. So that means I up and was born in Ohio, but actually really came of age in Indiana, came here to college, undergrad at Indiana Wesleyan University in Marion, Indiana, in Grant County. So solid 5th district. Now I live in Hamilton County in Carmel. So still the 5th district. Spent a little bit of time in Chicago, outside of Chicago, getting my master's degree in journalism at the Northwestern University Medill School of Journalism. And am a contributing editor for Indianapolis Monthly, Politico magazine, and also am the publisher of Importantville, which is sort of like Politico's playbook, but for Indiana politics. So it's been fascinating. I was on assignment for the Washington Post on the first day of early voting here in Hamilton County and Noblesville. And, you know, turnout has been historic. I think that's fair to say and accurate. On my first day of voting, I've talked to a black couple, retired postal workers who, were Biden and Harris voters. I think they were emblematic of a surge in people who are going to vote early because they are, number one, concerned about the coronavirus in terms of, you know, being safe and voting early so that they avoid crowds on election day, but also people who want to really make their voice heard and who may have not have voted in past elections and are really sort of increasingly engaged in a way that we haven't seen prior to sort of the Trump era.
So you mentioned, Hamilton County, the 5th Congressional District. There are a lot of eyes nationally, not just here in the state of Indiana, that are on this race. What are just the kind of the dynamics with regards to the 5th District and what is making it so, top of mind for folks? I mean, we've had both Senator Spartz and former Representative Christina Hale have joined us for teletown halls to talk with members, AARP members within the 5th district. And there's just a lot of interest in this race. So I'm just interested to hear kind of what has made this so high profile and kind of what you're seeing when you're out there reporting about it.
Sure. So if you think about the 5th district, this is a district here in Carmel, where I am right now, just down the street at the Palladium. President Trump held a rally here in 2016 ahead of the primary elections. His headquarters was here in Hamilton County in Carmel as well back then. Over that period of time from 2016 until now, we've seen a significant shift in Carmel in particular from, you know, people who are supporting the president to people who are slowly shifting to kind of a Democratic voter profile. J.D. Ford, which represents the Senate district here, a Democrat, is the first gay elected official to hold office in a state elected seat, openly gay elected official. And so that happened in 2018. He defeated incumbent Senator Mike Delf. You look at Zionsville, which is here in the 5th District. They have a Democratic mayor now. Several Democrats are on the city council here in Carmel, as well as in Fishers. So I think slowly you're seeing the suburban district. Granted, there are rural parts of the district in Grant County, Blackford County, but you're slowly seeing this district over the last 4 years kind of trend a little bit more blue than you would expect in this particular part of Indiana. And so, you know, this race matters because you essentially have kind of an open seat. Susan Brooks, the outgoing representative, has retired, is going to be retiring, is outgoing. And so it's an open seat. And you see someone like Christina Hale, the Democrat in this race, who kind of has her home base in Broad Ripple in the southern part of the congressional district. She's making a very serious run here. And you see kind of a lot of older voters, you know, sort of leaving the Republican Party, or at least leaving their allegiance for President Trump due to his response to the novel coronavirus. And so this district is really a good bellwether for how suburban districts nationwide are going to trend come Election Day.
And so you've mentioned suburban district, and that's kind of, you know, being right outside of Indianapolis. And then there seems to be also a lot of people talking about within that suburban vote with regards to suburban women. Is there anything that you're seeing, or, you know, we've heard the president talk a lot about, you know, suburban women and things like that when he's out and about. There seems to be this focus with that even subset of just suburban voters that people are really paying attention. And like, have you seen or talked with anybody around that gives, I guess, credence to that, to what people are looking at in regards to that?
Yeah, my sense, Jason, is that talking with suburban women voters is that they are, you know, really sort of turned off by the Trump presidency, by the Trump era Republican Party. Even here in Carmel, where you have a lot of traditional GOP women suburban voters, they don't like the tweets. That feels cliche to say at this point. But they don't like, you know, the general sort of backlash that the president has had toward, you know, issues and movements that matter to them. You know, here in Carmel and as well in Fishers in Hamilton County, we've seen Black Lives Matters protest happen here over the summer. And so this isn't the suburbs that we knew maybe 4 to 8 years ago. You know, suburban women here are interested in fiscal policy, fiscal discipline, but at the same time, you know, they care about, you know, issues like immigration. They care about issues like diversity. You know, last night we heard in the debate, the presidential debate, about the 545 children who have been separated from their parents after illegal border crossings. You know, that's an issue that resonates here among, you know, Carmel moms who, you know, it isn't difficult for them to imagine being separated from their own child. And so, you know, I think certainly we're seeing kind of a sea change in what makes up the average suburban, you know, female vote here in Hamilton County, which is a crucial county when it comes to the 5th Congressional District.
And we touched on it a little bit before. So we have this, you know, with regards to early voting, and there's obviously high interest in this election. And then now there seems to be even more activity around people voting early. When you've been out there, is it been, you know, COVID-19 that's driving a lot of people out to vote early? Is it just the general enthusiasm and wanting to be involved in the process? What are you hearing in regards to why people are coming out in droves to vote early?
Sure. It's all of those things. I think broadly, when talking with voters, I think one of the big driving factors is the sense that, you know, they sort of, you know, sat out 2016, which, you know, was a consequential election. It is not a partisan sentiment to say that Republicans have remade the judiciary under President Trump, whether it's at the Supreme Court with a number of nominees, or whether it's, other sub, regional judiciaries. So, Republicans have remade the judiciary, and I think a lot of people, voters, kind of have that top of mind. They sat out, they lost their voice, and now they kind of want to matter again. They want to sort of put their thumb on the scales of democracy, so to speak. And so they're coming out in droves to vote. A number of the Black voters that I talked to who were early voting have said that they're concerned, about police brutality, about their rights as Black citizens being encroached upon by sort of a white police state force. I think that's part of the reason that's that people are voting in record numbers. I think people are thinking about healthcare, not only younger people or retired people, but I think senior citizens are focused on the future of Medicare, rightly so, and Medicaid in the states. And so I think many people are sort of realizing for the first time that this just isn't a horse race. This just isn't a culture war. But what's happening at the ballot box really sort of impacts their day-to-day lives. And it's really hitting home for them in a way that hasn't before in previous elections.
Okay. So the 5th District obviously is garnering a lot of headlines, especially here in central Indiana, but just in general, a lot of folks paying attention to it. But there is, Indiana is one of those, I guess, rare states that has their governor's race the same time as the presidential race. And this year, it seems like the governor's race has been a little bit, I guess, under the radar, so to speak. So just what are you hearing in regards to the governor's race here in Indiana?
Well, look, I think sort of the top lines are Governor Eric Holcomb is really sort of in no danger in not being reelected. And I think the flip side of that coin is, there's a real sort of antipathy among Democrat officials and Democratic voters in what they see as kind of a lost opportunity. They look at someone like Dr. Woody Myers, the Democratic candidate here for governor. They see an eminently qualified person, someone who, was the chief medical officer at Ford Motor Company, someone who was the former, state public health commissioner here in Indiana during the AIDS pandemic in the 80s, who fought for the rights of Ryan White. They see someone who held a similar position in New York City, someone who is really nationally the only Black gubernatorial candidate on the ballot nationwide during a racial uprising, during a second civil rights movement. And they're disappointed, and rightfully so. This is someone who, is independent in terms of their financial means, could have, donated much more money to their own effort, to their own campaign, and just hasn't done that. And so, because of the strong run that the Libertarian candidate Rainwater is making in this race, there's a real sort of alternate history where the Libertarian takes a significant chunk of the vote from a vulnerable Republican, and the Democrat could have won the gubernatorial race for the first time in more than a decade here in Indiana. So You know, I think that's the lay of the land. There's a lot of frustration on the Democratic side. You know, I think that we're headed towards a race that will yield the highest, number of votes for a third party candidate in the history of the state. And even still, despite that, I think, Governor Eric Holcomb is a shoo-in for re-election.
Okay. So less excitement for the governor's race than what you're seeing in the 5th district. Yeah. All right. Well, I mean, I think it's very interesting to see, just obviously nationwide, but then just here in Indiana. I think it's also something, and it's because you, and this is kind of not specific to the 5th or Indiana. I'm going to throw a off book question to you because you do, do some reporting on the national level. We are seeing, obviously, the 50 plus voter is always the set of voters that you can count on are going to show up every single election. They've often been the deciders in these races or in elections. It seems like, and I think that this year that is also the case. And it seems like, you know, some of our AARP colleagues in other states that are, you know, battleground states with Senate races and things of like that, they've done some polling of the 50 plus voter, and it seems like they are up for grabs this time around. And so I just didn't know if you had seen kind of anything similar when you've been out there reporting around, you know, the 50 plus voter and kind of what they're looking for.
Yeah, you know, the 50 plus voter is in a really interesting spot. For many of them, they have invested into the stock market and they are seeing, you know, booming 401ks, or at least did before the novel coronavirus hit. And, you know, they may say at the same time that they are better off than they were 4 years ago. However, many of them that I've talked to look at the president's handling of the coronavirus and, you know, have some questions. They have some concerns. You know, they are over 50, which means that they are in a population of voters that may be more predisposed to, having a significant bout with the coronavirus and maybe, you know, have some pre-existing conditions. And they look at sort of how the president, even if they support much of what he's done in office, whether it's tax cuts, whether it's decreasing regulations, but they look at the way that the president has handled the coronavirus and they have questions. They wonder if, under him over the next 1 to 2 years, as the virus continues to sort of wreak havoc, because it really doesn't appear to be going away anytime soon. We know from the CDC that maybe, 2022 is the earliest where we can stop social distancing. And so they really have questions about mismanagement in the Trump administration when it comes to coronavirus, even in spite of supporting the president on so many other issues. And so when you look at the over 50 group, my sense is they're really wrestling right now. They're wrestling with sort of a lifetime devotion to the Republican Party, many of them. And I think they're consequential in the president's reelection efforts. I think they will be, in many ways, the deciding voice, not only here in Indiana, but nationwide. If the president wins reelection, it will be because of the 50 plus demographic. If he loses, it will be because of the 50 plus demographic. So I think they really are the most consequential voters, not only in the presidential race, but in the 5th, in the governor's race. We are an aging nation. If you look at the demographics, we are as old as we've ever been. And I think voters in that cohort have the most influence that they've ever had.
Okay. Well, that's, that's kind of what we always say as well. We, the AARP folks and the 50 plus voter are the ones that you can always count on to vote and turn out. Adam, I appreciate you taking the time. Appreciate the work that you're doing around and reporting what's happening in the 5th district, the governor's race, and elsewhere. And once again, thank you for joining us. For those of you who are so inclined, you can visit importantville.com, where you can see more of Adam's work and see what's happening in the state of Indiana. And then for here at AARP, if you want to know what's going on with AARP Indiana, you can go to aarp.org/in. There's going to be a whole host of information there, especially for around this upcoming election. And Adam, anything else before I let you go and get about your, you know, busy day, I'm sure that you're having. Anything else you want to add?
Sure. Yeah, I would just say that, you know, regardless of what happens, whether, you know, the Vice President, Mike Pence, and the top of the ticket, Donald Trump wins, or whether Joe Biden wins, I think that we'll continue to see sort of a Hoosier delegation at the national level influencing policy. If Vice President Biden wins, you'll see people like Joe Donnelly, you know, Pete Buttigieg, you know, Ron Klain of North Central fame, really influencing and pulling the levers of government. If, you know, Vice President Pence wins and Donald Trump win re-election, I think that you'll continue to see Hoosier influence there across the government. So whatever your political persuasion, it's good to be a Hoosier in 2020.
Agreed. And just in every day. And we appreciate you joining the ranks of Good Fine Hoosiers here. And we thank all of you out there, Hoosier or not, for joining us and watching this video for us. So until then, stay tuned to AARP Indiana for more activities that the AARP Indiana team is up to. And we will talk to all of you again soon. Thank you.